Good afternoon. Outcome based education. Today actually we will cover the outcome based educational pyramid and constructive alignment. Now in that outcome based educational pyramid, before that I will know what is the program educational objectives, program objectives. First, program educational objectives, a broad statement that describe what graduates are expected to attain within a few years of graduation. That is the program educational objectives. Input from the students, parents, faculty, alumni, employers and managements is used to validate the definition of the program educational objectives as well as assess their achievements. So, the program educational objectives, the guidelines for the PEOs are, PEOs should be consistent with the mission of the institution. So, what is the mission of this institution? The program educational objective, there should be a relation. So, the number of PEOs should be manageable, not too much PEOs. So, it should be manageable. PEOs should be achievable by the program. So, whatever we expect, it should be achievable. PEOs should be specific to the program and not too broad. Okay. And PO should be based on the needs of the constituencies. So, this is the program educational objectives. So, what are the stakeholders? Are already I mentioned that the students, faculty members, parents, alumni, industry managements, that is very important, professional bodies, data on the future, data on developing trades in the profession, etc. Now, program outcomes. Program outcomes, this is the narrower statement. Program educational objectives is a broad statement. So, outcomes are the narrower statement that describe what students are expected to be able to do by the time of their graduation. So, PEOs are expected to be aligned closely to the graduate attributes. Okay. Program outcomes, it should be very specific and it should be measurable and it is achievable. Program outcomes transform the PEOs into specific student performance and behaviors that demonstrate learning knowledge and skill development. Engineering undergraduate programs must demonstrate that the students attain the following outcomes. What are the 11 outcomes? One is the ability to apply knowledge of mathematics, science and engineering, ability to design and conduct experiments and interpret the data, ability to design a system, component or process to meet these needs, ability to function on multidisciplinary teams, ability to identify, to formulate and to solve all the different engineering problems, not only to know if they to solve it or to formulate it, that the engineering students should do, understanding of professionals and ethical responsibility, not only the knowledge, not the ethical responsibility and the impact of engineering solutions in the global, the social context. So, in the global, the ethical, they should help, you know, in the society. Ability to communicate effectively and the motivation and ability to engage a lifelong learning. Knowledge of contemporary issues and the ability to use the techniques, skills and modern engineering tools necessary for engineering practice. So, all these are learning, what learning, these are 11 outcomes where in these things they can achieve one or two points. Now, the course or the subject objectives. These are the statements that describe what students are expected to attain in terms of specific knowledge, skills and attitudes after completing the course or the subject. Course or the subject objectives are based on the syllabus content of the course and the subject. So, these are all the teacher centered, right? But course or the subjective outcomes, it describes that what students are expected to know and be able to do at the time of the completion of the course. So, this is not the teacher centered, this is the learner centered. So, these relate to the skills, knowledge and behavior or attitudes that the students or the learners acquire as they progress through the course or the subject. So, these are very specific, they are measurable and of course, they are student or the learner centered. Points to be remembered while setting the course outcome. It should be student focused, not the what the faculty focused, it is not that. We are focusing the student here. Align the course, program and the institution level. Whatever the institution objective, there should be a balance in the program and the course. State in terms of the knowledge, skills, attitude and ability that the student will acquire, and it express in terms of a measurable and observable behavior. Need to reflect the objectives, outcomes and mission of the academic program. So, in the pyramid only in the picture, you can understand. Focus on the aspects that will encompasses students' new mode of thinking. What the student is thinking, the new mode of thinking, that is the outcome best. The course outcome should focus on that. Limit to the manageable number, 3 to 4, not more than that, to be accomplished with the course or the semester. And it begin with the action verb, already the action verb, but always try to avoid here the verbs such as, you know, understand. These are vague, these are not. So, the proper action verb, design, evaluate, justify, this type of action verbs. Now, here you can see one this pyramid. In this pyramid, in the top, university vision, school or college, university mission and their school or college mission. Already I explained you that the vision and mission. In the top is the university mission and then there is school or the college mission. After the school college mission, the program mission. Program mission. In the program mission, that's the program goals. So, here program objectives and the program outcomes. There should be a balance in the program objectives and the program outcomes. Under the program, the course, course objectives and course outcome. And in the course, lots of different units are there. So, course unit instructional objectives and course unit instructional outcomes. So, it is a pyramid structure. So, the pyramid image is chosen to convey the fact that increasing complexity and the level of specificity are encountered as one moves downward. So, the pyramid structure also reinforces the notion that learning flows from the mission, from the top mission of the institution down to the units of instruction, university, school, program and in the top, in the bottom, the unit level. So, this is the outcome based educational pyramids. To sum up, program educational objectives are to be limited to 3 to 5. Program outcomes are minimum 1 to 11 or more. Program objectives are limited to 2 to 5, and the, according to the course objectives is 2 to 5, and course outcomes are limited to also 2 to 5, because there should be a match between the objectives and the outcome. Outcomes are broken down into 1 to 4 objectively measurable performance criteria. Now, I'll explain what is the role of the faculty members. Take responsibility as a mentor, counselor, facilitator, guide, learner, and finally, as a teacher in the outcome-based education system. Introduce research activity for students in the undergraduate and the postgraduate levels. Prepare the student adequately so that they can succeed. Create the positive environment. You have to create a positive environment in which the students know that they will be helped in their learning, no matter how easy or difficult they might find the learning process. The main thing is you have the, as a faculty, you have to create an environment. Help students understand what they have to learn, why they should learn it, and how they will know when they have learned it. So, there is a coordinate, you should coordinate as a faculty, you should coordinate with industry and get their feedback and input in the curriculum development. Then only the total development can possible. Improve placement by introducing outcome based education system sincerely at all levels of the program. Involve all the faculty members of the program, course and the assignment design. Then only the total development can possible. And provide faculty development programs, that is very important to improve and update the quality of pedagogy. Provide modern tools to teaching and learning methods. So, these are the role of the faculty members. Now, the constructive alignment, there should be alignment, what's that? First, some questions comes to our mind. What do you consider in designing a module? Who are my students? What are my aims or the learning outcomes? What outcomes do I hope students will achieve? What do I want to assess? How do I want to assess my students? What segments of content do I think are essential building blocks for students? What teaching and learning strategies do I want to use? In what modes will I deliver the course? So, these all questions as a teacher, it comes to our mind. So, the main that the constructive alignment is developed by Biggs. In the year of 1999, he mentioned that it is a theory of learning that begins with the premise that the learner constructs his or her own learning through relevant learning activities, according to Biggs. So, here in this picture, it is also developed by adapted by Biggs in the 1999. Here, just see here the intended learning outcome, where there is a learning and teaching activities and the assessment meal, there is a link. Designed to meet the learning outcome and designed to assess the learning outcome. So, the intended learning outcome is the important thing, and there should be an alignment. Now, what is alignment? First, I'll see the constructive alignment. The key to achieving the goal is that all components in the teaching system, each aspects from the inception to completion, they are aligned to each other to facilitate the achievement of the intended learning outcome. So in the picture you can notice that there is an alignment, right? So what's that? Thus the curriculum, the intended aim, learning outcomes, teaching methods and resources what we are using, and the assessment tasks and criteria for evaluating all are all aligned. So alignment is very important. So alignment is the central to effective assessment. So there should be a clear relationship between the learning outcomes and the assessment. So there should be an alignment. So here the advantages of this constructive alignment is that this is obvious. Learning activity being aligned towards and the needs of learners and the needs of the assessment allows the students. Why? The advantage. So the students progress successfully. So a classroom either online or blended or traditional method, it would be chaotic. So if the teacher choose intentionally to allow learners learn on their own and assist in another. So it means that during the learning journey, a student will rightly experience a wide variety of teaching methods, assessment methods and the learning activities. But Biggs proposes that generally learning and assessment that should be aligned. So first just see here, this is the alignment. So first the aims, and the aims, the intended learning outcome. So methods of learning, assessment methods and tasks, criteria, here marking and the feedback. So the what's the first, defining the first, the intended learning outcome, that is the aim. Choosing teaching or learning strategy likely to lead the help and encourage the students to attain those objectives. This is the second part. Third one is the engaging the students in these learning activities through teaching process. As a teacher, we should engage the students. Assessing the students' learning outcome using methods that enable students to demonstrate the intended learning and evaluating how well they match and what was the intended. So that is an arriving in the final grade, and perhaps in the case of the formative assessment, giving feedback to the help the students to improve their learning. So this is the in the picture. In this picture, it is very clear. Now, then the constructive alignment here, we can see this is the learning objectives, teaching learning strategies, feedback and assessment methods, and the context process content. So, here, constructive alignment is an approach to course design which begins with end in the mind, that is, what the student knows and what be able to demonstrate at the end of the course. So what is the skill set? That is very important. It assumes that when the learning objectives, assessment methods and teaching learning activities, here just learning objectives, the assessment method and teaching objectives, they are intentionally, if they are aligned, then only the outcomes of the learning will improve substantially. This is according to Bloomberg in the year of 2009. So that is important, that there should be, there is an alignment and intended learning outcome is the major part. Thank you.